Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're on Shasta Lake in Northern California for some outstanding rainbow trout fishing. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television. It's a perfect mid-August morning on Shasta Lake, and we're with guide Bob Tellis, who's joined by Gary Morales of Max Lure and Australian tackle representative Rod McMullen, who runs RMC Tackle and is now bringing Max Lure products to trout anglers in Australia. The day ended up as probably the best day of trout fishing I've ever experienced on Shasta.
Well, you're going to have some stories to tell when you get home.
And began with putting the right lures in front of a concentration of big, healthy Shasta Lake rainbows. We're in the Waters Gulch area.
Well, we're marking fish, looking good this morning. We'll get us up to speed here. And we're having showing fish about 60 to 50 inside there. And we're gonna play around here. Probably be fishing around 60 on our shallowest, and Gary will probably take us down to about 80 to 150, anywhere in that area. He likes to always go deep. The deeper, the better.
So what I'm putting on here first thing this morning is the Glow Shad. This is a Super Glow Crippler. And this thing will hold the charge, send it down early morning like this, like start off with those, just gets a little better shot. Once the sun gets up, and then we'll switch out to some of the silver stuff, a little brighter. There's my Prokia.
That? You want some shad?
Yeah, you shad. Let's do shad. You know, the lake is full of shad in here, so the old shad gel from Procure is first thing I always go to in this lake. Sometimes I'll add shad and garlic, so you know, that's another combination that works quite well.
Okay. Well, besides shad, we'll put out some garlic plus. That works well, and we'll mix it up, and we'll use a little Amsoil krill.
In this morning, because it's, you know, quite dark, we're going to go to the UV glow sling blade. It has a little glow as well as a UV. That'll work better in the early morning. And again, the shad, we have the white wiggle hoochie, which is a good shad imitation, but I actually take a black felt pin and I'll put a black line down the back of it. It just gives it more of a shad look, and we did real well with this the other day.
We sat back probably about 20 to 30 feet, somewhere in between there, because we're fishing so deep that we don't have to let that much line out behind the boat because we're going down. So we have plenty of distance, you know, and it's not gonna bother the fish, or, you know, so we will have, hopefully we'll get bit here real soon. This is the humdinger in the fish scale, and we're gonna entice it with a little bit of garlic plus.
Just like Shasta Lake in Australia, in our cool water lakes, we do have the rainbow trout, we have the brown trout, so very similar here to America. So what the gear they're using here today would work very well here in Australia.
You know, one of the things I like about Scotty Downriggers is if you need to get down fast and you're getting into a lot of fish, well, you can let that lever go and it'll drop in a hurry. We're gonna run down to 75 here to start. And when we're setting up, you know, I put the first one in the back here, I put that down at 75 feet. I'm gonna run this one at 65, about 10 feet above. And I like to set my lines a little further back on that stacker or the second rod. That way if the fish is looking at that bottom lure and decides it doesn't want it, it leaves, it'll come back and it'll see that upper lure coming by, and a lot of times you'll pick those fish up. Got it, next release. No, it's already released. Yeah.
That's that humdinger. That's on that nice humdinger.
He's putting up a fight at the end here.
Good. It's a good fish. Oh, out of the water, yes. Love it. That's a nice fish, man. Nice fish. good start there, buddy.
Yes, it is.
Take those all day long. Look at how fat that fish is.
You hit out on that crippler, or I'm sorry, on the humdinger, on the fish scale, and that's what we put that garlic scent on at. Works absolutely wonderful out here.
Boy, he ate it too. It's hooked up good.
Couldn't stand it up.
He wasn't going anywhere. You know, it's not a real big fish for Shasta, but look at the girth on that fish. I mean, this time of year they've been feeding on so much bait that they just get, you know, big. Oh. they're feisty even out of the water.
For today's fishing, we recommend the Cousins KC801-1TG rods, Daiwa Lexa 100 or ICB 1SL line counter reels, P-Line 10-pound Fluoroclear with 8-pound Shinsei leader, Gamagatsu's number 6 or number 8 round bend trebles on the Cripplers and number 4 big rivers on the Humdingers, and Threadfed Shad, Anise Krill, or Garlic Plus Super Gel on all your lures. Welcome back to Shasta Lake. I'm Justin Wolf. We're fishing not far from Packers Bay, where we found a concentration of shad-eating rainbows as well as brown trout.
Man, that's 2 in a row on that lure.
Trying luck.
One thing I learned a long time ago is the lure's getting bit. Oh, got the net. Whoa, man, you look like a little brown in the sand.
Small
little
brown. Pull some line out. There you go.
Man, that's a small brown, but
we might be able to save him if we hurry. You know, lately, believe it or not, we are catching some nice browns. Especially being this late in the year, we're in the middle of August, and water temperature up on top is running 82 degrees, and we are catching some nice browns. Now, particularly, this is a small one. Hopefully, we can put them back.
Yeah.
You know, well, let's get them back in the water right away.
There he goes. You know, they don't stock the brown trout in here, so it's all pretty much naturally reproducing. So it fluctuates a lot on the numbers that we get in this lake. You know, there are browns that up into the 20s in here that have been, personally I know, hooked and lost. But you can get a lot of fish, especially in the springtime, that are in the 10, 12 pound size. I believe the lake record is 16 something. But when it comes to brown trout fishing, Shasta's probably your best opportunity to get a big fish. Just got bit on that glow crippler. It's a decent fish. Well, look at that fish pull.
Straight to the back of the boat. There you go, attaboy.
Feels like a decent one. Well, you know the thing about the fish in here, Bob, they're just tough.
I mean, they are tough. They have some real shoulders on them.
They're eating good. And they're feisty. Boy, he said shaking good. I love it. You know, a little breeze.
Perfect.
Nice and cool this morning. Doesn't get any better than this, does it? I'll tell you what, this fish is decent, bud.
That's perfect.
Here we got. Now look at this fish. Lengthwise, not that big, but boy, he sure was. Got some weight.
Oh, he's pretty. He is pretty.
Pretty fish. That's Pitt River string now.
Yep, he is.
Look at the color. Look at the color. Well, he inhaled that.
Yeah.
Well, you can see this is actually a Pitt River strain rainbow. Typically, they're going to have these little spots on them, and they're usually a little brighter in their color. That pink stripe on them. Even though we're a long ways away from the pit, those fish are everywhere in this lake.
They fish migrate around. Some of them, you get, they have to look like an Appaloosa on their belly.
Yeah, especially when they get towards spawning season. I was using shad gel on that. We'll go ahead and put a little more in there again. We'll continue to use this combination until the sun gets up, and then until we'll switch over to the probably UV silver combo.
We're marking fish right through here, about 60, 70 feet, but right above that, you can see these clumps right there. That's bait. That's our shad schooled up. These are fish marks right underneath some of the bait, a few right through them with them. So we have some good opportunities in here to pull out some really nice trout right now. Come behind you, fish on.
Is it?
Yeah, he hit. There he is. There he is.
Make sure he's there.
He's there.
He's there. Well, that was a pretty subtle hit.
Yeah. Well, at that depth.
Well, Bob increased the speed, and then straight away, Gary's got a hit.
We're trying to maintain a speed about between two and two and a half miles an hour. It seems to be working the best. Give us a good opportunity to work the lures.
Let's see if this one can be released.
Yeah, I'm sure we can.
With a little jump.
Oh, no, he's going to go. There he goes. Perfect.
All right, two on this side, two on your side. That glow crippers. Get some momentum.
We're on Shasta Lake, where the eagles catch fish with their talons, and we use hooks, and some simple modifications can be helpful.
Fish on. There you go. One of the things I like to do on the Crippler is this is a size 8 hook that we put on these, and the reason's always so that a variety of fish sizes can eat them, obviously. But what I like to do out here where you got some bigger fish, I like to kind of flare those hooks out a little bit, just bend them a tad. Just widens the gap, you tend to get a little deeper hook set. You know, most of your tackle companies are going to put a good quality hook on their baits, but they got to keep the prices somewhat reasonable. And so, you know, a lot of your professionals will go to an upper end hook just, you know, for, you know, that little extra sharpness that you can get sometimes on those upper end hooks. Like a Gamagatsu hook, for instance, good quality, very sharp, and you can change those out on, you know, pretty much any of your lures because they got the split rings there. And I can actually change them out by hand if I had to. You slip them right out. Put your other hook on. Slip it down. And then back on. And there you go, ready to go. The Humdinger comes with a single sidewash. And what I like to do with that, just to increase your, you know, hook sets, I'll actually offset that hook. Bend it out a little bit. So what happens is when it slides into the mouth of the fish, it rolls and it'll hook up better. Just adds a little more depth when you're set.
He's on.
He's on.
Perfect. Excellent job.
So that fish came back and hit that. Sometimes you can change your speed up when you got a fish you know it's following like that. And then speed up, slow down, speed up, and you'll get them to hit that way too. Or I like to do this trick, like we did. You were laughing yesterday.
Yeah.
As soon as I did that, bam. You know, Ben Ramonda used to do that all the time.
That's because he would get you. You guys would get bored.
Yeah.
That's something to play with.
Yeah, that's it. How's that one feeling, bud?
It's feeling good, Gary.
What every boat needs out here in the lake, when you look at it, a bunch of downriggers and a big long net.
Yeah.
All right. Bring him straight in. Lift a little. There we go.
Nice one. That's a good
one. Well, that one's not very fast. But nonetheless, decent fish. If you look, as soon as the sun came up, that silver fish scale got spanked. That's a good combo in it.
Yeah,
once the sun gets up on it, it's got all the colors in it. Looks a lot like a flash you'll get off the side of a shad.
Gary, do you need to match your sling blade pattern and color to your lure?
Well, it's not so much color as it is the flash, you know, depending on what you got. If you got dark conditions like in the morning, you go to the glow, colored stuff, more fluorescent. But once the sun gets up, yeah, you want to go to the silver, when you're going to silver lure, whether it's silver blue or silver. If you're in deep water and there's a spectrum as far as depth and light penetration, the pattern generally, if you're on top, go to red, gold, chartreuse, green, blue, and purple. And blue and purple are your UV colors. And that's what we got here. We're in deep water, we're running the UV silver, so that's a perfect combination for deep water for that low light.
Fantastic, right.
You know, this is August on Shasta Lake. Typically in August, we've got, you know, shad schools everywhere, balled up in the thermocline down there, and you'll see them, and you'll catch primarily trout or salmon in that thermocline depth. But we've been actually catching some bass as well as trout at the same depth, which is really confusing to me. So I'm kind of wondering what's going on the temperature side. And I've seen these on the show course, and it'll actually give us a complete reading all the way down, what, every 5 feet, I guess, as we drop it, and we can take a look at temperature. Obviously, what we're looking for on these trout and or salmon, 50, 55 degrees, no more than about 60. Now you can see on the surface temperature is 82 degrees. Now that, Shasta Lake gets warm, but for Shasta Lake this time of year, that is very warm. Which is great for swimming. That's why there's so many houseboaters and skiers and stuff out here as well. But anyway, let's just drop down. No difference. 15, 20. Look at that. We were in the 80s all the way till we got down to 30 feet. Unbelievable. Keep going. 69. So 40 feet. We're now at 69 degrees. Now we're getting in that range where you can catch trout. Now, obviously you can find bass there. We want to get down more under 60 though for the ideal temp. There we are, 75 feet where we've been catching our fish is 60 degrees. That's about the maximum temperature you want to find when you're trout fishing.
Welcome back to Shasta Lake. I'm Justin Wolf. Bob Tellis has put us on some great fish, but is also maximizing our chances with proper boat control.
Bob, you made that slight turn. You put the sun behind us, which increases the flash off that dodger and lure, and it got hit instantly. A lot of people don't realize that the sun's position will have an effect on how your baits reflect. If the sun's behind you, it's shining right down on those dodgers, and it's going to flash much brighter than it does go in the opposite direction away from you.
Okay, here he comes.
Yep, there you go.
Nice, nice.
Now, look at the length on that fish.
Wow.
It's got that same UV tape that we've been using for years on the sling blades, and we add that little bit of a fish scale to it, and it just looks so much like a shad down there. When that sun gets up, it's just deadly.
Oh, he feels
that's
good.
That's a good fish. That's a real good fish. I can tell by the way he hit and went straight down.
Okay, he's coming in. He's got a nice fish. Look at
oh,
that.
Oh, nice!
Look at that.
Whoa!
Jerry, you need to move your stuff out of the way, buddy.
Out of the way.
Pick up your
dude, kit. That is 4+.
Get your cable up. Nope, you're good. Okay.
Okay, bud, try to keep it back. Keep him back. Hold on.
Watch yourself, you're going to get hung up on that. Well, that's a nice fish. That's our fish of the day so far. There you go.
Yeah, dude! That's a 5-pound fish!
Yeah, he come all the way from Australia and pulled some line out.
Look at that. Look at that, guys. Now that is no joke.
That's beautiful.
Whoa.
The biggest trout off to it.
They don't make them that big in Australia.
Oh, they do.
You guys haven't seen one.
Not my fish. Not all the time, I tell you.
What a beauty, man. On that fish, that fish scale crippler again. Whoa. Buddy, you need a picture. You need a picture with that fish.
Yeah.
Here.
That's a nice fish by anyone's standard.
You know, in our humdinger line, we actually have two sizes in that lure. We have the 1/8 ounce and we have the 2.5 inch, which is a 1/2 ounce lure. Neat thing about this humdinger is it's got that extra weight. You can either cast them or you can even jig this bait, and it works well that way. But for trolling, it's a little faster speed lure. The guys that like to troll up to that 4 mile an hour range at 2.5, 4.5, this is a fantastic lure for them. But it'll also work at those slower speeds. Today, we're running about 2.2. That lure will work today too. But we did notice that some of the shad, these bigger fish we're eating, are eating a larger size shad. I usually try to match the hatch. That smaller humdinger is usually a perfect fit. But with those bigger shad, let's go to that bigger bait and see if that won't get us a bigger fish. We just barely got back down and hit another double. We had a triple, now a double again. Watch another rod, we only got one left. It's gonna get hit next.
Oh, hey.
Nice. Look at that bass. That's a big bass.
That's a big bass. There's somebody's dinner tonight.
Oh, look, that's dinner.
There's somebody's dinner.
That's a smallie, isn't it?
No.
I probably got a bass here too. You know, you go through a school of them, but I think I got a trout. Yeah. We got a mixed combo.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking
what
about.
What did the bass hit? Mine hit a cripple.
Cripplers.
Both cripplers.
That bass, we picked him up at 85 feet.
Yeah. Slow down. I saw something on the screen too down there and dropped down and this is big fish on a camera.
Don't break my rod, please.
Man, look at this thing. Whoa. Hey, it's acting like a brown.
Oh, well, perfect. Just absolutely perfect. That's the cherry on top of the cupcake.
Well, it's heavy. You know, it's not, you don't feel that head shake. See, it pulls a real powerful. Look at that thing go. Look at that. Just, and you know what's going to top it off, Bob? This is our 15th fish, too.
Yeah.
We're done.
Oh, there you got color.
You see that?
Yep. Oh, that's a nice one.
Look at the girth on that fish.
Oh, watch that.
Oh, my God.
There you go.
Oh!
There you go.
Unbelievable!
There you go.
You know that fish earlier I thought was 5 pounds? Well, I was wrong.
Can you see the belly on this thing?
That thing has got to be.
Look at how much.
Six. That's a 6 pound rainbow.
Yeah. What's that on Gary?
That big silver humdinger, yeah. Man.
But look at the belly.
Look at this thing.
Full of bait.
That weight on that. Okay. Look at, you know, that fish is only like, 23 inches maybe? But look at the girth on it. Well, you're going to have some stories to tell when you get home.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.